Here at Spec of Tech, we've been covering the brand new Tonewinner subwoofers. They released a 15-inch beast, the D6000, and the smaller 12-inch brother, the D4000. I covered both of those subwoofers already, and those videos are linked in the top right-hand corner if you'd like to see them. But there's still one compact Tonewinner subwoofer to cover. And that's this guy right here, the 12-inch D2000. This subwoofer is perfect for anyone looking for great performance in a compact design, all while keeping the budget super low. This subwoofer has a small footprint, but still packs a pretty big punch, and we'll prove that with measurements, because in today's video, we're going to talk about room measurements and performance while we review the compact Tonewinner D2000. We're also going to do something that we've never done before on this channel. We're going to cover some drama with a recent channel hater. As you just saw, the D2000 isn't a large subwoofer, but its size isn't the only thing that's small. The price is small and affordable also. At the time of this recording, the D2000 is on sale for only $749, but its MSRP is $799. In Canada, it's currently priced at $999. It may be a small price tag, but it still packs a pretty mean punch with its 12-inch high excursion driver, 400-watt RMS, and 1500-plus-watt peak amplifier. Given its small dimensions of 16.7 inches wide by 17.2 inches high by 18.5 inches deep, and weighing in only at 50.7 pounds, you may think that it's a sealed subwoofer, but it isn't. Tonewinner placed a slot port on the bottom of the rear of the subwoofer, giving it a frequency response of 16 Hz to 220 Hz, plus or minus 3 dB. And I personally thought the rear port might make it a little bit more difficult to place, but I have it really close to my front wall and I haven't experienced any drawbacks yet. Because it's a slot port, Tonewinner doesn't offer a sealed mode on the D2000, but they still offer built-in Bluetooth for use with the free app. In the app, you can change things like the sound modes. You're given the options of your own PEQs, strong mode, deep mode, and normal mode. You can also choose between 0 and 180 degree phase, but there's been a recent welcomed update that now includes variable phase between 0 to 180 for fine tuning. It's good to see that Tonewinner is still actively updating these subwoofers with features that customers are actually asking for. And it does come with a well-built acoustically transparent grille if you're not the type to show off the driver. Now, when it comes to warranty, here's where we need to talk about some drama with a hater that I had in my comment section recently. I don't normally cover drama or get involved with haters on my channel because I don't really want to waste the oxygen on them, but in this case it's relevant to the warranty of the Tonewinner subs, and I also want to clear the air with some other accusations made during that drama because he made it quite public and personal. So I recently had this commenter, we'll just call him Pontiac Lover, but we won't judge him on his taste in cars. He was spamming my comment section about the warranty not being written on the Tonewinner website, only being written on the distributor's website. He essentially was writing the same comment over and over under other viewers' comments. I answered his concern by telling him, as far as I knew, Tonewinner was working with Summit Hi-Fi on the warranty and stated what is written on the Summit Hi-Fi's webpage is correct, and Tonewinner is backing him. I then asked him to stop spamming the same comment and even told him I would leave his main comment up, but would have to remove the rest of them because it's spam at this point. But that obviously wasn't good enough for him because he kept on with the same comments. So I muted him on my channel, and for the record, I've only muted bot accounts before. He's the first real person that I've ever muted because I do want my channel to be open to discussion, even if their viewpoint is different than mine. He then proceeded to go to a popular SVS Facebook group page and call me out for muting him and making it sound like it was censorship, which it clearly wasn't because he was spamming. And on top of that, he even called me biased in his comment, considering that he was upset for me using the title SVS should be afraid when I reviewed the D6000 simply because it does have better performance than some SVS subwoofers. It's pretty ironic for him to have SVS pictures in his profile and make a comment on an SVS fan page, then call me biased. Maybe he doesn't see the hypocrisy in that, but I'm sure it isn't fooling any of you watching this, and it sure didn't fool me. Because I actually do like the SVS brand, and I've said as much in my reviews of their products that I've done in the past on my channel. But I also have to call a spade on my channel. My point in my previous videos was simply to say that SVS is falling severely behind when it comes to their performance at their price point. And I feel like that's a valid point to make, considering that I had measurements to back it up. And that may hurt some feelings, and I'm sorry about that. That's not my intentions. I was merely trying to show the facts. And if that does hurt your feelings, don't shoot the messenger, which is me. You should instead expect the company that you're a fan of to just do better. In addition to that, in Pontiac Lover's post on the SVS fan page, there was an assumption made by someone else about me being on Tonewinner's payroll. I appreciate the assumption, but no, I wasn't paid one dime for any of these videos, and I had no agreement about what I should or shouldn't say. The videos are 100% my honest opinion. For the record, I do use affiliate links for these subs down in the description, but I also use affiliate links for the SVS subwoofers. I never let the fact that I'm using affiliate links sway what I will or will not say about a product. Not to mention, this is also a very common practice for YouTube reviewers, and I'm honest about it in my description. Being part of an affiliate program has nothing to do with what I say about a product. I would want a reviewer to be honest with me, so I do my best to be honest with you guys, even if that means saying something negative about a product. Just look at some of my past videos and you'll see that what I'm saying here is absolutely true. The reason I've been covering the Tonewinner brand is simple. Imagine that you had a small YouTube channel like mine. Now imagine losing thousands of dollars buying products to review and then having to sell them after. A retailer comes along and is willing to provide you some products for review. You just have to send them back after you're done. Well, that's exactly what happened with these Tonewinner subwoofers. Summit Hi-Fi was willing to send them to me for review, but they all need to be sent back eventually. They are not mine to keep. Anyway, long story short, I was merely showing that Tonewinner subwoofers have more output than the SVS subwoofers that are significantly more expensive. I can't change the facts. I show these measurements to the viewers only to show where the value in output is, and in this case, it was with the Tonewinner subwoofer. I didn't mean to ruffle any feathers. I wasn't trying to pick fights with the SVS fans. I honestly thought that people would want to know that a less expensive subwoofer can outperform a more expensive one. Correct me if I'm wrong down in the comments below. Do you guys want to know which subwoofers outperform the other? Or should I stop doing that to avoid hurting people's feelings? Anyway, although I feel Pontiac Lover went about it the wrong way, he did sort of have a point that Tonewinner didn't have it in writing on their website that they were supporting Summit Hi-Fi and their product with the warranty. Well, I'm glad to inform you that they have now added it, as you can see here. They support the 3-year warranty on the driver and amp, along with the 5 years on the cabinet. Sorry about the drama, guys, and sorry I got a little bit long-winded, but I thought it was warranted covering because Pontiac Lover decided to make it public and also decided to make it personal with his post. I also wanted to point out that Tonewinner wants to be there for their customers and is listening to what you guys have to say. All right, so that's enough of that. You guys came here to see the Tonewinner D2000, so let's get back to it. This budget subwoofer has some impressive output and sound quality. I know that the opening scene of Edge of Tomorrow isn't the greatest way to test a subwoofer, but it is a torture test that I like to perform on subs that I'm reviewing. And for a budget subwoofer, this D2000 handled it very well. It shook my fireplace and other things in my room pretty violently. I wasn't really expecting that for such an inexpensive and compact subwoofer, so kudos to Tonewinner for packing in such output in such a compact design. Now, obviously, you can't expect the same SPL levels as something like the D4000 or D6000 or any other larger, more expensive subwoofers, but for its price, it really does hold its own. Why not have a look for yourselves while I play the Edge of Tomorrow opening scene? And just for fun, here's the interstellar wormhole scene. This little room shaker has great performance for home theater, especially if space is an issue. It's so small but still has that rumble to satisfy a bass head. It's good quality bass also. It has that nice low throaty tone to it that remains clean and agile until it's pushed to its limits, of course, but this compact sub has some pretty impressive limits for its size. I also tested it with Billie Eilish's NDA and Eminem's Killshot, and yet again, this little guy impressed. Why not take a listen for yourself? Thank you. So hopefully you can hear in those demos that this little guy does pack a punch. Obviously, again, you can't expect the same output levels as the larger D4000 or D6000. And speaking of performance, let's have a look at the RU measurements in my room. And RU stands for Room EQ Wizard. I'll show the PB2000 Pro measurements with the D2000 measurements as well. Keep in mind that the PB2000 Pro is significantly more money at $1,100 US or $1,750 Canadian versus the D2000 MSRP of $799 US or $999 Canadian. And again, this isn't an attack on SVS. I'm not trying to hurt any feelings here. This is what most viewers want to see to show the level of performance the D2000 is capable of at its price point. I would have compared it to the SVS PB1000 Pro, but I've never measured that subwoofer in my room before. But the PB1000 Pro is closer in price to the D2000 for those that are wondering. All right, guys, so here we are on my computer, and you can see I already have RU pulled up. I want to point out, though, that I took these measurements without the speakers. So I turned the speakers off because I wanted to measure the subwoofer only. And I left the crossover at 80 hertz. So you are going to see that it starts to drop off in the higher end. And the reason I did that is because for some reason, that's how I measured the SVS PB2000 Pro. And I wanted to compare these measurements. So I had to do them exactly the same so that I could compare them. I don't know why I measured or why I only saved the measurements for the SVS PB2000 Pro without the speakers with the crossover still in place, but that's what I did. So in this case, that's what we're doing here. But when you're looking at these lines, I want you to assume basically that the SVS PB2000 Pro and the Tonewinner D2000 can pretty much be flat across the board. I'll show you what I mean here, starting with the D2000 in normal mode. So I'll just pull up all the volumes here in normal mode. So as you can see, it starts to drop off pretty hard here, close to 80 hertz. So just imagine that this line is pretty much fairly flat. Obviously, you're going to still have room modes and whatnot. But this big drop here is because I left the crossover in, I left the 80 hertz crossover, and I turned off the speakers. So, and I already explained why I did that. Anyway, so let's have a look at the compression testing for normal mode on the Tonewinner D2000. You can see that this blue line at the top here is clearly compressing. So let's get rid of that blue line. This green line seems pretty evenly spaced because what you want to see is 3 decibel increases, and it looks pretty evenly spaced here. So we'll keep that one as our max output for normal mode. So for some reason, these Tonewinners usually do have a peak here at about 32 hertz. So we're looking at about 111 decibels for their peak. And over here at 20 hertz, we're looking at basically 99 decibels. And then I did measure them down to 15 hertz. But as you can see, it's not an aggressive roll-off. For such a compact subwoofer, that is pretty impressive to see. And you're looking at 93 decibels still at 15 hertz. For such a compact, inexpensive subwoofer, not bad at all. That's pretty impressive, to say the least. Like, there's not much else I can say about it. The output on this little guy is absolutely impressive, and you can see that here in normal mode. Now, let's have a look and just show you the differences between normal mode, deep mode, and strong mode. So we got deep mode, or normal mode here at negative 24, deep mode here at negative 24. So as you can see, at somewhere around 37 hertz, it starts to deviate a little bit, and you have a little bit less high-end output in deep mode, but you do have an increase in the low end in deep mode. So it depends on what you want here. You are going to sacrifice a little bit of the higher frequencies to get the lower frequencies. And then here we have strong mode, which gives you a little bit more in the upper frequencies, but as you can see, it sacrifices the lower frequencies. And these are at the exact same volume, so this is the response that you would expect. And then, of course, you can do your own PEQs as well. So I did that just to kind of show you guys what it looks like. So we'll do, I put 2 PEQs on just to flatten this area here. So I believe one was at 32 hertz and one might have been at 37 hertz. But because I didn't want to affect this area here too much, I had a pretty tight Q on them. A tight Q, basically that just means it tightens up the frequencies that it's affecting. But as you can see, you can flatten this out quite nicely just using the PEQs that are built into the Tonewinner subwoofers using the app. Absolutely impressive output for this little subwoofer, no question. And with a couple PEQs, you can flatten it out. Even if you don't have room calibration, that's what's nice about the app on this subwoofer. You can kind of do your own thing and flatten out the line and make it a little bit more conducive to your room just with the PEQs. All right, so now let's have a look at the SVS PB2000 Pro versus the D2000. So these are the SVS PB2000 Pro measurements. And as you can see, same thing here. For some reason, I measured it with the 80 hertz crossover on and turned the speakers off. I think just because I wanted to see the subwoofer response itself. But I should have removed the 80 hertz crossover and maybe put it to about 130 or 140 hertz so that we could show this. I don't know why I did this. This was quite some time ago. I must have had something in my mind that I wanted to see, and for some reason these are the measurements that I saved. So my fault, my mistake. Sorry about that, guys, but this is what we have. So I measured it the same with the D2000 to make it fair. So as you can see, these two top lines are compressing. This orange line compressed and this green line is clearly compressing. So we won't use either of those as the max. So we'll use this blue line as the max. We'll get rid of these two. And then for normal mode, I believe it was negative 18. So don't pay too close attention to the nulls and peaks. You kind of want to take an average of the line. Again, this would have been flattened out. So chances are the SVS sub line could look something like this. So it would flatten out to about here. And then the Tonewinner D2000, you could flatten out across here pretty much. But what we want to see here is kind of the comparison in output. Clearly the SVS from about 28 hertz down to 15 hertz does have more. No question, you can see it here. Let's just have a look at 20 hertz. So 20 hertz were 99 decibels on the D2000. And 20 hertz on the PB2000 Pro is about 103, 104 decibels. So there is a clear difference here in the low end. The PB2000 Pro does have a little bit more. But then from 28 hertz and up, it's no question that the D2000 is putting out more output, like by a significant margin. And like I said, the below 28 hertz, it is significant, but not as significant as the high end over here. So it kind of depends on what you're looking for, but considering that you could get two of these right now for $1,500 and you still have pretty respectable low-end output, but the mid-bass output of these two would be impressive, absolutely impressive. But like I said, it depends on what you guys want. It depends on what you're looking for. But considering the price difference of the D2000 versus the PB2000 Pro, that the output here is absolutely respectable. And it's incredible that they can have this output in such a compact design. It's just absolutely incredible. They did a phenomenal job. There's no question about it. But yeah, there you guys have it. These are the measurements. I'll let you guys make up your own minds. But these are the facts. And this is what it looks like. All right, so that's it for the room measurements. Let's jump back to the review. After having a look at those room measurements, Tonewinner impresses with their performance yet again, just like the D4000 and the D6000. They're just incredibly hard to beat in the performance category at their price. You can see it offers incredible value even when put up against the more expensive SVS PB2000 Pro. In all honesty, it's probably one of the best performing budget subwoofers on the market, and it accomplishes that while still offering the bells and whistles of the competition, like Bluetooth connectivity and a free app. So if you are someone that wants a compact design but doesn't want to compromise on output, the D2000 is a subwoofer that you should have at the top of your list. It performs very well in home theater and music, especially when taking into account how small it is and how inexpensive it is. The D2000 would be a great way to get multiple subwoofers in your space with the least amount of budget. As I already mentioned, I have dropped links down in the description below, and please do use my links if you plan on purchasing. It really does help out the channel so I can keep bringing comparisons like this to the viewers who want them. And guys, remember to enjoy your systems, no matter how big or small. I'll see you on the next one. Cheers.